We had already studied the crystal field theory of coordination complexes, some of the limitations of the coordination complexes in case of crystal field theory, as well as the ligand field theory or the modified crystal field theory. Now, we shall study about the molecular orbital theory of the coordination complexes or the transition metal complexes. Before we start with the molecular orbital theory, I have to tell you that it is a little complex than the Werner's theory or the crystal field theory. Now, we will have to consider some of the term symbols or the symbols for the explanation of molecular orbital theory. So now, it consists of the symbols like A and then E and T. So here, A refers to non-degenerate orbitals and the T is triply degenerate and E is doubly degenerate. So now, the symmetries or these symbols can vary from tetrahedral to octahedral systems. For example, in case of octahedral complexes, the p orbitals are represented as t1u. But when it goes to the tetrahedral complexes, the same, the p orbitals are represented as t2 orbitals. So therefore, those differences will be studied under the headings of the molecular orbital theories of octahedral complexes as well as the tetrahedral complexes. Now we shall see what are the requirements for the molecular orbital theory. Now, in order to explain the molecular orbital theory, we have to consider that the atomic orbitals which undergoes the combinations, we say the additive linear combination, must have the same symmetries. And the second assumption or the second requirement says that they must have the similar energy, or if they are having difference in energies, and it should not be too large. Now, if the atomic orbitals are of unequal in energy, then the bonding molecular orbital will have the major characteristics of the lower energy atomic orbital, and the antibonding molecular orbital will have the major characteristics of the higher energy atomic orbitals. Having said this, we shall move on to the molecular orbital theory of octahedral complexes. Now, when we refer the octahedral complexes, we all know that here the metal is surrounded by six ligands. Now, these molecular orbital theory of octahedral complexes can be studied under two headings. One is the sigma bond formation, other one is the pi bond formation. Now, we shall concentrate on the sigma bond formation. Now, the molecular orbital theory of sigma bond formation in the octahedral complexes says us that the six ligands will provide six filled p sigma orbitals, and therefore we are seeing that each ligand is providing one p sigma orbital for the formation of the sigma bond in the case of octahedral complexes. So, from the group theory, we can say that the symmetries required for the sigma bond formation in the case of the metal as well as the ligand orbital combination is done. The A1G, T1U and then the EG symmetry. So, the T2G symmetry, whichever is present in the metal orbital, will be considered the non-bonding molecular orbital that we shall discuss a little later. Now, at the first, the A1G symmetry of the metal S orbital will undergo overlapping with the p sigma ligand orbital combinations to form A1G bonding molecular orbital as well as A1G antibonding molecular orbital. In the similar way, the T1U symmetry of the metal p orbital that undergoes linear combination with the ligand p sigma orbital combinations to form T1U bonding molecular orbital as well as T1U antibonding molecular orbital. The same explanation could be given for the EG orbital or the EG symmetry also. So, EG symmetry of the metal orbital which represents dx square, y square and dz square orbital undergo overlapping with the linear combination of the p sigma orbitals of the ligand to form the EG bonding molecular orbital as well as EG antibonding molecular orbital. Now, let us consider that these six ligands are providing six p sigma filled orbitals. So, therefore, there will be a contribution of 2 electrons each from one ligand, and therefore, total of 12 electrons are contributed to the sigma bond formation in the case of metals. So, therefore, these six sigma p sigma electrons are filled up to the level that is EG. So therefore, these 12 electrons are filled in such a way that the 2 electrons are placed in bonding A1G and 6 electrons are placed in the case of T1U, and there are 3 T1U bonding molecular orbitals, or total of 8, and other 4 electrons are filled in the EG bonding molecular orbital, and therefore these electrons are filled up to the EG bonding molecular orbitals. Now the T2G that remains as the non-bonding molecular orbital, which is of pure D or pure metal character, therefore these D orbitals are called as the pure D orbitals of the metal. Therefore, crystal field theory can also be explained in this bonding. Hence, a gap between the T2G non-bonding as well as the EG antistar or the EG antibonding molecular orbital could be taken as the crystal field ligand or the crystal field splitting in the case of octahedral complexes. Now, we can say that the metal electrons, which are pure metal d orbital electrons, can be distributed between T2G as well as EG star. However, the T2G is the pure metal d orbital. However, another one, the EG, is having characteristics from both metal as well as the ligand, and therefore it is not a pure d orbital according to the molecular orbital theory, because it's also having some contribution from the ligand. Hence we can say that the electrons which were previously present in the metal d orbital now distributed between T2G and EG star, which will can also be considered as the crystal field splitting in the case of the octahedral complexes. Now, to conclude here, I can say that in the sigma bond formation in the case of octahedral complexes, the better suited symmetries we observe. They're from the group theory is that A1G symmetry, and then the T1U symmetry, and then the EG symmetry, where A1G represents S and the T1U represents P, and the EG orbital represents the 2D orbitals dx square, y square, and dz square. Thank you.